money as we possibly can to build a community center on this much needed block called O Block. It's called O Block because it's named after a young man named O.D. Berry who was shot in Houston. The gangs took the O in his name and started calling it O Block. We decided we're going to keep the O, but we're going to change it to Opportunity Block. I want to thank Fox Network for giving me the opportunity every day to bring you the Rooftop Revelations, where I share with you my thoughts, viewpoints, and opinions. George Floyd and made millions of what they call the pain of black people. This is simply reprehensible. I just read the Washington Examiner report that said millions are unaccounted for. After all the three original Black Lives Matter leaders have currently resigned, the amount given was 60 million. 60 million, I believe, is probably far more. If there's no accountability within Black Lives Matter board, and if there's such shadiness within the organization over all the money, and you can bet there's even more money that's being hid. What angers me is how disrespectful and selfish Black Lives Matter is. They claim to care about black people more than anyone, but where are they? I don't see them around here. Believe me, we got plenty of work around here to do, and we would have no problem putting them to work. If Black Lives Matter really matters, then why aren't they here? Do they not see the same weekly headlines that we all see? What makes me especially mad is that we have had black lives and blacks like these who milk black pain for money ever since we came out of slavery. We call them trickster figures. When Booker T. Washington wrote these words over 100 years ago, he was describing to me BLM today. He says, and I quote, there's a class of colored people who make a business of keeping the troubles, the wrongs, and the hardships of the Negro race before the public. Having learned that they are able to make a living out of their troubles, they have grown into the settled habit of advertising their wrongs, partly because they want sympathy, and partly because it pays. Some of these people do not want the Negro to lose his grievances, because they do not want to lose their jobs. Let me repeat. Some of these people do not want the Negro to lose his grievances. Let that sink in, folks. You know who they're talking about? The folks right here. Right here in these streets. They want these folks to stay beaten down and downtrodden. They want to hold up the very people whose lives that they're trying to improve for the last 20 years. And they want to hold these people up to Americans and say, see how bad you treat us. Give us money. That's what Black Lives Matter does. While buying houses for themselves all over America, headquarters in Canada, the article even said that Black Lives Matter folks dropped nearly $26,000 for meetings at a Malibu resort. Hey. It hurts me even to say the word Malibu as much as I'm freezing out here in Chicago, trying to raise awareness for the real problems that my people are going through. It shames me to see brothers and sisters exploiting our pain. It truly does. Let that be a dark mark on the heads of BLM. The jig is up. Meanwhile, the work continues here every day. We continue to mentor, we continue to counsel, we continue to offer pathways, opportunities, and we will never stop doing what we are called to do because that's what we have to do. If we're ever going to change the lives of people on the south side of Chicago and inner cities across the world, we must continue to work.
It looks like it falls outside the feeling it came from ruined name, human, and beast.
Of BLE.
That's why.
Well, as I always say, these are just my thoughts, viewpoints, and opinions. Thank you for tuning in to Rooftop Revelations. God bless you, God bless America, and until tomorrow, peace.
It looks like it's in a cow family or
Okay, so I'm remaking all these videos. I've got 4 videos that would not upload. And I did a lot of talking in them, so I didn't want to waste them. So I'm trying to recopy them now. I'll try to put them up on the Miguel Everyone channel and see if they go up. I might be locked out of this channel too, I don't know. But videos are not uploading to YouTube on any of my channels right now.
Fox Network gives me an opportunity every single day to bring you rooftop revelations, where I share with you my thoughts, views, and opinions, and oftentimes bring you some special guests. Today, I'm really, really excited to bring you a brother who runs one of the most fantastic schools in the city of Chicago, where the proficiency of reading is high, math is high, the students are excelled in excellence, and they do not lower the standards at all. I want to talk to him about that school, and I want to talk to him about all that he does for the great city. He's on the west side of Chicago, so we won't hold that against Jim Irving, Providence, St. Bill. Jim, how you doing, man? I'm doing great today, guys. How about yourself? I'm doing great, man. I know you're a graduate of Purdue and all of that, but I want to thank you for the work that you do at Providence, St. Bill. Can you just tell us about Providence, St. Bill, if you would? All right.
our students accepted into college, but finding scholarship dollars for all of our students, not just the top students, but also the C students. We've had students who graduate from Providence St. Mel with a 2.2 GPA and get a full tuition scholarship to a four-year university where they can finish and finish college without any student debt. I tell people all the time, a college education is valuable, but a free one is priceless.
That's right. So because, you know, they got that scholarship because of your standards. You know, I don't want people to think, oh, 2.2 or 2.4, but they don't understand how rigorous the school is. When you compare Providence St. Mel to other schools in Chicago, especially public schools, there is a drastic difference in the quality of the students. The standards are high. The dress code is implemented. But you all even make sure that parents are involved.
Yes, we want to make sure we keep our parents informed. We meet with our parents at least once a quarter. Whenever students have an issue, we make sure we call home. So it's a partnership. The parents have to be involved with the education of their children. And they should want to be. And because we're a private school and the parents pay money, they're motivated and incentivized to be involved. We have great parental support at Providence St. Mel because we keep them involved. We're very transparent. We let them know what's going on about the good, the bad, and the ugly when it comes to their student. And so we want to make sure that we are doing our part to keep them informed.
You know, one last question. Tell people about where the school is located, because those who are watching who are outside of Chicago, they may not understand the geographical location, but I want them to understand where this school is thriving, where it is.
Providence St. Mel is located on the west side of Chicago in East Garfield Park, one of the toughest neighborhoods in the city. Murder crime rate is very high. Violence is definitely prevalent in the neighborhood and surrounding neighborhoods. And so our students, when they get to Providence St. Mel, they know they're safe because the school is built to look like a castle on the outside. And it feels like a castle on the inside. And the students feel safe when they are in there. They feel safe when they're in the school. And we make sure that we don't have any foolishness going on inside the school. And our students are safe from the time they walk in that building until they get in the car with their parents. Or if they have to walk to the bus stop.
Well, thank you. You know, for over 40 years, y'all been doing a great job making sure the students go to college, making sure the students meet the standards, not lowering any standards just to give students a quick fix, but you all keep the discipline intact, the parents involved, and I want to just take a moment just to thank you all and appreciate you all for what you do.
Thank you. Can I say one other thing? They have an open house this Saturday at Providence St. Mel School, 119 South Central Park Boulevard, for parents who are looking for a new school. Whether it's for pre-K, preschool, all the way through 11th grade, we are accepting applications for the 2022-2023 school year. Our open house is this Saturday, January 29th at 10 a.m. at Providence St. Mel School. We invite all parents to come out with their children and see the school and see the magic of Providence St. Mel.
And what's the website, Kelsey? There are people from all across the country who go check y'all out. So what's your website? The
website is www.psmnow.com. PSMnow.com.
Thanks, man. I appreciate you.
Thank you.
Like I always say, we really appreciate it. Thank y'all for tuning in.
should just mention that these are mineral streets that are laid out all the time. You can see them above everyone's head. They're above all your heads all the time. Anybody can grab a camera and go grab a video of these mineral streets. Digital collection of electromagnetic nanocarbon from the cloud level, I call it. And just open your eyes and you'll see it all. It's not being hidden. It's all hidden in plain sight because you keep looking at your computers, you keep looking at your cell phones, you're looking at your televisions, you're reading the books, you're taking all the programs, but you're not looking around and seeing the reality of it. Nothing scary about it. Just what it is.
Supreme Court has agreed to hear two cases challenging admissions policies at Harvard and the University of North Carolina. I'm not going to go into all the depths and details of both cases because that is not the point of this rooftop revelation. But both cases generally ask if racial preferences can be used in college admissions. My answer is a simply flat out no. And for those of you wondering, no, I've never used affirmative action. I've never benefited from it. I'm one of those folks that in the 2019 Pew Research Center poll that found that 62% of blacks said that race should not be used in college admissions. We all know it's a shame. I'm proud that I got to where I am because I worked hard and gave it all that I had. I know that many of my fellow brothers and sisters feel the same way. My problem with affirmative action is that it helps nobody in our community. Our schools are so bad that even our smartest students struggle to get the education that they rightfully deserve. And what bothers me about affirmative action is that it is essentially the government saying, we will help you when you're 18. You can struggle from pre-K to 12th grade in a crappy school, and we will not help you. When you apply to college and turn 18, we're here to help you, good old government, help you get into college. How in the world does that make any sense at all? We're so far behind in this neighborhood that it's not funny. When they graduate 12th grade, some of them are really at 9th grade levels. So we give them a plan of action, and all of a sudden, our students are years behind in college. Many of these students aspire to be doctors or scientists. They choose those majors in college, but many simply cannot compete with students from other schools. And what happens? They drop out, or they switch to easier majors. Why are we doing this? We could have easily had those same students take a slower path upward. Community college, state college, and then graduate school. Let them catch up. Let them keep their dreams. Several years ago, I saw a documentary called How Jack Became Black. Full disclosure, the producer of Rooftop Revelations, Eli Steele, made this film. What struck me about the documentary is that it explained that the original purpose of affirmative action, the original purpose was to go into poor, underdeveloped communities and provide better teachers, better funding, a pathway to opportunities. The problem was that this development would take time, though. University presidents wanted blacks on their campus now, so they showed diversity and they switched from the original purpose of affirmative action to racial preferences. They wanted blacks no matter what. They wanted blacks no matter where they came from. And the other truth is, the first blacks that benefited were middle to upper class blacks, not the blacks from this neighborhood. So affirmative action has not helped us one bit. Here's an even uglier truth. The top colleges in America are fighting over a small pool of very talented black applicants who could have gotten into colleges on their own. These colleges had no interest in development. They wanted the quick, easy fix. They wanted to look good and brag about purpose is to correct yourself. Because our nation chose the path of racial preference. We're now in a racial war of sorts. What bothers me about these lawsuits is how they discriminate even against Asians. I've been discriminated against, and I would not wish that on any person, not even my worst enemy. Why in the world would they discriminate against Asians that have worked hard and paid their dues? What kind of America are we becoming? See, what I'm getting at, affirmative action is poisonous because it uses race as its primary principle. This has allowed Americans to overlook developed black communities. This has allowed Americans to discriminate against Asians simply because they look different, the color of their skin. Are you serious? This is why we need to do away with the affirmative action for once and for all. And if we do, then we will have nothing between us and our problems. We won't have lies. We won't have the lies of affirmative action to hide behind. The problems will be raw, naked, and right in front of us. We will have to address them for once and for all. That is why I support that affirmative action. As I always say, thank you for tuning in to my rooftop revelation, my thought, my opinion, my viewpoint. Till tomorrow.
Trust the Biden administration to protect our civil liberties, period. They abused their power on COVID, they abused their power in the way they handled the January 6th situation, and they trash our country's history every chance they get. After 13 months of President Biden, Americans have every reason to be suspicious of anything they do that involves collecting information about Americans. I'm talking about lists, databases.
Yeah, and Candace, this is the thing, this is why I brought this video on. Okay, Second Amendment rights, they got everybody worried about their guns, and as I explained in an earlier video, you can go back, Obama already proved it, that they're not going to take away anyone's guns anyways. That's only to get everybody fighting, arguing, but as far as a takedown of America, now they're just going to take out the bullets. Not gonna have any bullets. It's easy enough. Shut the power down. We also have pulse waves that we know how to use. We can use pulse waves and take down everybody's cell towers real quick, so that no one can communicate with each other. This could all happen under, again, a false flag weather conditions or something like that. They're just testing it over the last 60 years, each thing that they do, and testing it. How many laws were started after the towers went down in New York is unbelievable. But the thing is that the Democrats work on one side and the Republicans work on the other side, and they're both working for the same goal, takedown of America. So, as far as Republicans go, you're voting for Trump, you're rooting for him, and he's got everyone nationalized, and everyone's, America, America, and all that, which is nationalism, and that's great, and everything like that, but you're not paying attention to reading between the lines of every move that he makes, and things that he says, and then all of a sudden you catch yourself. That's why I say you got to step outside the box, because what you'll do is you'll catch yourself yelling, yay, when President Trump said, anyone who burns an American flag should get 1 year in jail. Remember that? So he says that, and then you got 4,000 people in the crowd. Candace, I don't know about you, but 4,000 other people all thought that that was a great idea, and they cheered him on. That's what I'm talking about, going so far the other way. That's why Biden will tear it, do his part. Biden's doing an excellent job right now, even though all the things say that he sucks and he's fucking this up and fucking that up. Exactly right. That's what he's supposed to be doing. And then Trump will come in and play that he's going to clean up the other side, and then most likely it'll be Michelle and Hillary ticket or something like that along those lines on the other side, and we'll break up the country that way. But as far as our Constitution, it was never there. They broke it down days afterwards. It's never really been there. And hope that, you know, as I'm showing you the true system, you'll be able to look at some of those things and understand them, because I think that's the hardest part about seeing what it is I'm trying to show you, is that it's so hard to believe that everyone in your life has lied to you. How could I have been so stupid, you might say, whatever. Well, don't beat yourself up about it. It was all part of it. How do you break your programming is very difficult. So, you know, that's all I can say about that. Don't beat yourself up about it. It was all of us. That's how I feel better about it, knowing that it wasn't just me. Because when you start looking around and you start showing people what I'm showing you, then you'll know. You'll say, oh my God, thank God it wasn't just me. They're all fucking zombies. Second Amendment stuff, yeah, Obama's already done that. We know that. Yes, they have lists, and yes, all the guns are now computer chipped. Obama, when he was in, he had 8 years to do it, and he started right away. His first year, we saw on Craigslist, he had antique. There were agents that were working directly for the president at the time, and they would do is come on Craigslist and buy up all the old guns. They went disguised as antique gun dealers. And you got to know this because you got to know people that were selling them their guns. They would have brand new guns that they would trade them, valuable guns that were a lot more valuable than what these people had. The deal was, the people that I knew, that I got to talk to, they had most of them had their grandparents' equipment. So, like, one dude lives a couple towns over, he had 4 or 5 bullet making machines, presses, for making bullets and stuff like that. So that was one thing they were buying up like crazy. So he told me about that, and he said that also they were doing the trade. He had gotten to do some trade. He was surprised because he got traded guns that were worth, you know, $150, $200, even to an antique dealer, they wouldn't have been worth that much, but he was getting $800,000, $1,200 guns that he couldn't even afford in a trade from some of these gun traders and gun dealers, and they presented themselves as collectors, you know, of antique guns and shit. What they were really doing is taking all the guns out of that didn't have computer chips in them. They were taking them out of play the same way they were doing with the bullet making equipment, so that you couldn't get bullets unless you got them from the store, from a dealer that way. And then he also, by the time Obama got into his second term, what he did was he took all the bullets off the shelves. He said he was using them for the soldiers needed them, all hollow point bullets and all this kind of shit. And everybody's saying, well, wait a minute, why they're not using hollow point bullets for what they're doing, why is he buying them all those? And it was fucked up, because a lot of people, my friends and stuff like that at the time, were always complaining about there's not enough bullets to go even practice with. So, and I watched them all, and I'm saying to myself, why don't they see this, you know? And I didn't know this at the time, of course, what I'm trying to show you now, but I knew we were being lied to about every fucking thing. So, yeah, so we're just going to play the same game this time. They're not going to fuck around. So, yeah, they'll make believe that they want your guns, but they really don't need them. That's just going to be a scare tactics and military on the street and a reason to get everybody to kill each other and shit like that. That's all. But otherwise, as far as the bullets go, that's how they're going to do that. They just take the bullets out of production, you know, they close down the factories, whatever, they can do that in any emergency situation, and then they just put their budgets through, and
we've got billions and billions of dollars worth of cameras all going up now. So we're going to be monitored. Every fucking thing we do now is going to be a camera in our asses, as if it wasn't bad enough as it was. So, I mean, communist country, capitalist free country, yeah, same fucking thing. Socialist, communists, same fucking thing. They're all the same. You know, capitalist, conservative, communist, yeah. You're just not seeing it yet. Alright, let's see.
More surveillance of anything, including your health records.
This is on play, so I'm just playing these clouds too.
You treat half of the country as if they're the mortal enemy. A threat to be controlled, not a constituency to be served. Now, when the school CRT and sexual assault issues bubbled up in the U.S., Democrats finally found themselves on the defensive. And then, Biden's Attorney General Merrick Garland, he swooped in to flex the power of the federal law enforcement. His words at the time were meant to intimidate and scare parents. If you're upset and angry at the direction your school board is taking, and you show up and you speak your mind, as is your constitutional right, by the way, now you have to be worried about being caught up in some bogus domestic terror dragnet. And rather than treat January 6th as a protest that got way out of hand, with some criminal elements, no doubt, the Biden administration and their media cronies insisted on claiming that it was an insurrection and treating everyone who supported President Trump as a traitor.
Not even during the Civil War did insurrections reach the capital.
Dates that occupy not only a place on our calendars, but a place in our collective memory.
So the false flags always happen first. The false flags always happen first. Nothing ever happens until it's programmed into us first. Crazy murders, killings, different shit that we do. It's always programmed. And I mentioned it in the beginning of this series, and I'll talk about it a little bit more while I got a couple minutes. Oh, man, 33 minutes. I'll try to get this in quick. Okay. Bullshit about the school boards going insane like this and everything like that. This has been going on for a long, long fucking time. As I mentioned before, Reagan brought in a lot of bad laws. I'm bringing up Reagan because you guys are Republicans and you believe in your side. So I'm trying to beat it on into you a little bit. Lots of bad laws came in under Reagan. So he was supposedly, he played it like Trump tries to play it, like he was, his arms were tied, you know, he had to take Bush. If he didn't take Bush, then he was gonna, you know, lose and all this kind of stuff. And he had to deal with all these things. And then, of course, Bush, you know, having him, tried to have him assassinated. And then they might have been the ones when he went to the doctors. That's the way Nancy felt about it, the way I understand it. And not that I think Nancy was anything good either, because she had a very terrible. But if you go read the books, you know, that everybody wrote for us to know the story, it went something along those lines. So Nancy always hated the Bush family after that, tried to stay away because she believed that when he went to the hospital for that shot is when they gave him the Alzheimer's. Or at least what was diagnosed as Alzheimer's, because he was never the same after that. And who you know, she, of course, she'd never say anything like that. She wanted to live a long, full life herself, so she wouldn't come out and say it. But other people that wrote the books didn't seem to be afraid to come out and say it. Okay, so about 6 years ago, we were getting a lot of the kids coming home with different reports here and there about lockdowns, what I was calling lockdowns. They were calling them shelter in place at the time still. So it was, 6 years ago or so, maybe more. But anyways, the kids were coming home with these. One was getting up there 20 times 1 year, 19 times another year, and then all of a sudden 23. So then 1 year hit like 28 times they had lockdowns. At the time, I had a scanner, and I used to listen to the scanner all the time. So whenever I'd hear the scanner, I'd go over and see what was going on at the school. Anyway, so this one time I did do that. We got like 28 that year, and I was pissed off. I heard it on a scanner. I'm like, what the fuck's going on today? So I go down to the school, and I bring the bell to go into the school, and I said, yeah, I just want to get my kids out. I know you guys are in lockdown. And then she said, well, what's lockdown? You mean shelter in place? And I'm like, no, I mean lockdown. It's like a prison here, right? So you guys got them locked down. I don't want to get my kids out. So, of course, and I know the girl. She knows me, and I mean, like, that's just, I wasn't being an asshole, and neither was she. So she was just telling me the rules. No, you can't, because we're in shelter in place. You can't take the kids out. And I said, well, what's going on in there? I said, I already heard three stories out here. One of them is that there was a white powder. Another one is that it's a bomb threat. And another one's that there's an armed gunman or some shit, or a story about an armed gunman. And she says, well, I can't say nothing to you. I said, well, none of those things make any sense to leave the kids in the school if you got this many cops around, because there was cops everywhere, stadiums, everywhere, fire department. And the most strange thing I thought was strange was that Channel 40 was right across the street standing on the armory grass all set up already. And I was there within 10 minutes of hearing it on the scanner. So they got there pretty damn quick, right? So I know about fucking false flags. I know that the Republicans do just as many false flags as the Democrats do. They all do these fucked up false flags. That's part of the programming us that you need a full-time police officer in your kindergarten fucking school or in your preschool. You need a full-time cop because these preschoolers and kindergartens are deadly, you know, killers now. I mean, it's fucking ridiculous, man. If you're gonna put a cop anywhere, maybe in a high school, maybe, but all these younger grades and shit, it's crazy to me that it works this way. And they'll do is they'll put the cop in the high school, but they're still working all the other grades anyways. It's the, you know, school police officer, which was a nice lady, and I like her and all that. But anyways, back to the story. So anyways, they wouldn't give me my kids. I'm out in the parking lot. There's several other parents that are there to get their kids for a toothache, dentist appointment, whatever, different shit. But none of them seemed to care that what was happening. So I'm like, this is kind of stupid, don't you guys think? I mean, you can't get your kids out. Think about it. If there's a bomb in their classroom somewhere or in one of the lockers, wouldn't it be best they all have side doors? Doesn't it make sense if you were a state police officer or if you were a local cop? Don't you think someone should be bringing up the idea of, okay, start bringing the kids out the side doors, bring them down, get them in a safe place until we can clear this area and make sure there's no bomb? If that was the case, right? No, so that wouldn't happen. The other one would be, okay, you have more than 30 cops on the scene, stadies, everybody, they're all carrying guns, okay? So we know that we're safe, that if we put 10 cops here and 10 cops there, that we can, again, make sure if there's a gunman in the fucking building, we can get the kids all out safely, get them into the next building, and then guard that building, and we know everybody's safe, teachers and children, whatever. Get everybody down to the other building, come out the side doors. We got enough officers here to accomplish that. This way we don't have to worry about it. Never mind this hiding under the desk for a nuclear war like we used to do back in the old days. They had us fucking hiding under our desk because we might get hit with a nuclear bomb. I mean, it's so fucking stupid. And then a whole generation's hiding under their desk. They never think about how dumb that is. If you're gonna get hit with a nuclear bomb, they should fucking send you home and say, you got 20 minutes. We might get hit with a fucking atomic bomb at that time, not nuclear, but atomic bomb we might get hit with. So therefore, everybody go home and hug your parents for the last time. No, they got us hiding under the desk because they knew we were never going to get hit with an atomic bomb. It's all part of the fucking slavery process, dumbing us down. So nowadays, they do it this way. So then what's the third option that they told us that it might be was the white powder. Okay, if you got white powder in a locker, if it's a deadly powder and it's an airborne substance that could, you know, poof up and dust when they open the thing, again, you would not want the children coming into the building from any of the classrooms. You'd want to get them out the side doors to another building until you can clean up and find out what the fuck it is, right? None of them things they did not do, right? So I get pissed. I go home. I make some phone calls. I call the chief of police. Called the head of the Board of Education, None of them would talk to me on scene. I seen these people on scene, but they would not talk to me. They kept telling me to get off school grounds and stuff. I said, why? Channel 40 is right there, so it can't be that big of a deal. So number two question, my couple questions to them was, why is it okay for Channel 40 to be there but not a parent? So Channel 40, and why is Channel 40 there before anybody else? Why is Channel 40 showing up at the same time the police are for something that, how did they know this was going to happen? How did they get there so quickly? You know, that's my question. Very fucking strange, very, very strange shit. But anyways, so I called everybody and I complained about it. And as I'm watching this shit go down in West Virginia, it's the same shit that happened to me. It's just that there's not that many parents that ever fucking cared. Not that many parents give a fuck about any of this, because I talked to thousands of parents, seriously, thousands of parents since this happened 6 years ago, and they don't give a fuck, man. They think it's all conspiracy nonsense. Anyways, I go in, So I make my phone calls. As I'm talking to everybody, of course I get accused of being a bigot, because everybody, the head of the Board of Education is a lesbian, the school cop's lesbian. I assured them I have no issues with genders. It's not a matter of anything like that. This is, and I like the cops, that are there. I have no problem with any of that. I'm just bringing up the simple fact that it made no fucking sense to do any of these things. So why bring anything else into it? Let's just talk about what it is you guys did as police officers. So as officers, oh, and I'll mention this too, from listening to the scanner for a long time, see, there's some things that you guys don't really... Oh, let me finish this story first. I'll get into the rest in the next video, maybe. So anyways, so after I make these calls, then what happened was, but took about a week or two, it was a couple weeks later, all of a sudden we all got a notice that if any parents show up to the school grounds during a lockdown, they should leave immediately or they'll be arrested. I'm like, you gotta be fucking kidding me. Even across the street from the school, parents are not allowed during the lockdown. But they did start calling them a lockdown after that incident. Even in the writing, when they were writing before that day, they always called them shelter in place. Now they call them lockdowns. So that's it. I'm already at 43 minutes. I don't think I can get the rest in. Let's see, 44 minutes. Yeah, I'll never get it. It's all right. But anyways, it's just a fucked up thing. It's been this way all along. There's nothing new about any of these policies. I don't know. Because it's being thrown in the zombies' faces a little bit more and stuff like that. Because even now when I'm watching the zombies on the news and stuff like that, I've been away from television a long time. People have not gotten any brighter. The zombies are still fucking zombies. I'm listening to them all and they're all like fine with the way everything's going and everything. And I'm saying, holy shit. You know, they're being dragged in a million different directions and it's fucking bad. It's really, really bad. And even in my own direct life too as well, I see it that no one's gonna really awaken. There's gonna be no true awakening that I always hope for. This is not gonna happen. I guess there's too much at stake, all of the money, all the guilt that everybody would have to feel if they were all called out for their lies. You think about the wars and all the death and all the things, all the sacrifices is what they are. Just like Candace was saying about the Aztecs sacrificing their children. We sacrifice our children all the fucking time. We just don't want to admit it. So we use our mirror neuron manipulator to bypass our mirror neuron for most of us. Then there's those that don't possess a mirror neuron, and that's why they're at the top of our human chains. Because if you don't possess a mirror neuron, you don't have to deal with feeling guilty and fighting yourself about feeling guilty and not knowing the difference, pretending not to know the difference between right and wrong,